It's Alex with Splunk Education. In this video, we'll learn how to create and manage alerts in Splunk.
Splunk uses alerts to proactively monitor your machine data in real time, allowing you to identify any issues, errors, or attacks before they impact your customers and services. We want to be alerted if there is an unusually high number of failed login attempts on our web server. So we run a search on our security index for all events containing the words failed and password. From the results page, we click Save As and select Alert. Then give our alert a title and optional description. We have the option to set permissions, making it private and only available to us, or shared with other users of the app. We will keep this alert set to private. Alerts can be scheduled or set to run in real time. Scheduled alerts are set to run on a specific schedule and trigger alerts when search results meet specified criteria. We call this criteria the trigger condition. Real-time alerts will also trigger an alert when conditions are met, but run continuously in the background, potentially causing extra strain on your environment. We can choose to run this alert every hour, day, week, or month, or set a custom option using a cron schedule. We will set the search to run once an hour on the hour. By default, triggered alert notifications will expire after 24 hours, but we can change them to expire after a specified number of seconds, minutes, hours, or days. An alert can be triggered by the number of search results returned, number of hosts in the search results, number of sources in the search results, or a custom condition that you define. We'll choose number of results. We can choose to have the alert fire when the number of results is greater than, less than, equal to, not equal to, or drops or rises by a specified number. Mistakes happen, so a single failed password attempt is unlikely to be cause for concern. But an unusually high number of failed password attempts may be indicative of risky activity, so we'll set this to is greater than 25. We can set the alert to trigger the alert action just once for all results of the search, or trigger the alert action for each individual result. As you can imagine, it could be easy to inundate users with alerts, allowing them to be ignored or filtered out. Over time, this may indicate that our previously selected value is too low, and that we should edit this alert to trigger at a higher threshold. Using the throttle option, we can suppress triggering multiple alerts after the alert has already been triggered. After selecting throttle, we can enter the amount of seconds, minutes, hours, or days to suppress alerts. If the for each result trigger option is selected, we're also given the choice to enter a field value to suppress. We'll choose to trigger just once and then add a trigger action. Here, we can choose one or more actions to occur when an alert is triggered. These include adding the alert to a list in the Splunk interface, logging an event to a Splunk receiver endpoint, outputting results to a lookup file, sending results to a telemetry endpoint, running a script, sending an email, sending a notification to Splunk Mobile, or using a webhook to post to an external URL. Splunk also lets you install or build custom alert actions. Users with an admin role can find and install pre-built actions using the Manage Alert Actions option. We select Add to Triggered Alerts and choose a severity to display for an alert. This will allow us to sort alerts by level of importance in the Triggered Alerts list. When we save the alert, we're given an option to edit permissions. Different options are available depending on your user role. We're using an admin role for this demonstration, so we can choose to display the alert by owner, the current app, or across all apps installed on the instance. Clicking on App or All Apps, we can choose read-write permissions by user role. We choose to give read access to every user of the current app and click Save. We're now taken to our alert page, where we can see details of our alert settings and edit them by clicking the link next to them. If any alerts have been fired, they will display at the bottom of this page. Using the Edit menu on the right, we can open the alert in Search, edit the alert, or its permissions settings, disable the alert, clone the alert, or delete it. We would like to know in real time if one of our servers is throwing a 500 error when a customer tries to make a purchase. So let's create another alert. We run our search, then expand the Save As dialog, select Alert, and give our alert a title. We are going to make this alert shared in app. To create alerts as soon as trigger conditions are met, we select Real Time. As with the scheduled alert type option, we can choose to be notified by the alert based on the number of results, hosts, sources, or a custom condition. The default option of per result will trigger an alert whenever a result is returned. If we have a server issue, we could easily get hundreds of alerts in a matter of minutes. So we will throttle our results. We will use a wildcard as the field value in order to suppress results for all field values and suppress triggering alerts for 30 minutes. We'll add the action to Add to Triggered Alerts, set the severity level to high, and click Save. Since we chose the Add to Triggered Alerts action, we can view any triggered alerts by selecting Activity in the Splunk bar and clicking Triggered Alerts. Here, we can filter alerts by toggling between different apps, owners, severity levels, and alert titles. We also have quick access to view results, and depending on permissions, links to edit the underlying search or delete the alert. We can view and edit alerts from the Searches, Reports, and Alerts link in the Settings menu, or from the Alerts tab for the app the alert was created in. Here, we can see our saved alerts and filter by owner or keywords. We also have options to see information about our alerts and edit and manage them.
This is just the beginning of what you can do with alerts. We suggest you check out the documentation, watch additional videos on the Splunk How-To channel, and register for courses from Splunk Education. Happy Splunking!